स्टूडेंट्स लेट्स डू ब्रह्मनाद। ओम ओम शांति शांति शांति। स्वस्थ।
Good morning students, welcome back to another video lecture from your chapter that is Sexual Reproduction in Flowering Plants. In last 2 to 3 videos, we are discussing about in details about the processes of sexual reproduction in flowering plants. And already we have studied the pollination part. And in the pollination, we have studied that 2 types of pollination are involved in the flowering plants. One is your self pollination and another one is your cross pollination. And by the definition, we know that the self-pollination, it is occurring in a single plant and only a single flower is involved. But in cross-pollination, there is involvement of 2 flowers that may be of your same species or of a different species. And for this cross-pollination, we have studied different contrivances, or we call it as your outbreeding devices. And these outbreeding devices that will promote the cross-pollination, we already know that. And basically for the transfer of pollen cane of single flower of one flower to the next flower or the another flower of the another plant or of the same species, that will need the agent. Through the agents, these pollen canes are basically transferred from one place to another place. And basically in today's class, we will learn in details about the different types of agents that are involved in the process of cross-pollination and how these agents will involve and how they will transfer the pollen grain from one place to another place and what are the characteristics feature of these pollinating agents, we will learn in this lecture. Okay. And today's topic is your agents of cross-pollination. And agents means that agent may be your biotic agent and that agent may be your abiotic agent. Basically on the types or basically on the requirement of different flowers, the agents will change in different types of flower or in different types of plants. Okay. On agents of cross-pollination, obviously the term or the definition says that here the cross-pollination involves, as we know that in self-pollination process there is no involvement of different pollen grain of another flower, then there is no requirement of agents in self-pollination. Only agent is required in cross-pollination. Yeah. Then today's class we learn about the different agents of cross-pollination. Usually in cross-pollination of this type, cross-pollination occur through external agency. And that external agency may be of 2 types basing on their requirement. Okay. That agency may be of 2 types. That is, one is your biotic agency and another one is your abiotic agency. And the biotic agency, bio, we know that bio term refers to the living organisms. Clear? And anything that is related to agency are mostly your living organisms. But in case of abiotic agency, most of the agents or the non-living agents are included. In the biotic, living organisms are included, and in the abiotic, there is involvement of non-living vectors. And that non-living vectors, if you take an example of your air, air is a vector for cross-pollination, it will be water. Okay. And in the living organisms, we will see different types of insects, different types of animals, birds, then snails that are included in the living organisms. Later we will know how these organisms are involved in the pollination process. Okay. And basically, first we'll discuss about the abiotic agents. And first one, that is your air pollinated flowers. And basically, air pollinated flowers are called as your anemophilic. And the flowers which are pollinated by air, we can call it as your queen, mutually. Anemophilous flower. Flowers are pollinated by queen, or you can say air. Queen, or that is what I should say. And some basic features or important characteristic features of your anemophilous flower. And that characters cannot be seen in case of other flowers. And that characters mainly include here. The flowers are odorless, colorless, nectarless. There is no presence of any scent or any color or any nectar. Basically, these flowers are devoid of any color or nectar. As we will see in the insect-pollinated flowers, how these flowers are colored and they are having their nectar. As here, queen is involved in the pollination process and there is no attraction is needed for the flower. That's why these are nectarless and colorless in nature. And basically, another important point of this anemophilous flower is that flower is inconspicuous. Cannot see by our naked eye. These are very small in nature. Okay.
These are very inconspicuous things, very small, not showing. These are not showing. And another important feature of inconspicuous flower is that can be seen by naked eye. These are easily identified.
As these are very small in nature.
Okay. And they are not showing. If you say the insect
anemophilous flower, those are insect pollinated, that we will know how these are showy in nature and these are having different types of colors.
But these are not showy and that cannot see by naked eye.
And important another feature is that the anther is versatile.
It is
an important point for this flower.
Versatile also means that we will see the anther. I will draw it as suppose we know that this is the anther. And these are the filament. This is the filament. And this is the anther. And in versatile type of, this is the arrangement of the anther, that is called as versatile anther. Why it is called as versatile anther?
Because the filament here, it is connected to the anther near the central point. It is near the central point, the filament will be attached. Why it is attached to the central point?
Because when there is air will be blown to the surface, suppose air will be blown to the surface of the anther, then the pollen grain which are present in the anther, that will can be easily, these are supposed pollen grains. Okay, these pollen grains can easily
spread or easily
simultaneously spread when the wind will blow the anther surface. Okay. And at that time when the anther is matured,
that will release the pollen grains, and mostly that's why the versatile anther, where the filament is connected to the central point or near the middle region of the anther,
that is called as a versatile anther.
Another several types of anther are present. Suppose one anther is there, that is called as a basic yeast.
This is your filament,
and the filament, it is attached to the base. This is the base of anther. This filament is called as a basic yeast. Basic yeast anther. Another type is present, that is known as a toxic yeast. Okay. When the filament is attached to the
dorsal side.
Okay. When the filament, this is dorsal side, dorsal surface of anther, dorsal surface, and this is called as a dorsal yeast. Okay.
These are some basic types of your anther.
Based on the attachment of filament,
we can differentiate the types of anther.
Okay, clear.
Diagram is shown in the picture. You can see that diagram, and you can differentiate the types of your anther.
And basically, the versatile anther, they will release the pollen grain,
and pollen grains will be blown to the different region, and that pollen grain should be lighted well. Okay.
Another part for that, pollen grains are light and small in weight. Light in weight and a small in weight.
As their weight will be very light, then it can easily blown by the air surface or by the wind, and it can fall on the surface of the flower, and it can involve in the fertilization process. Okay.
And another important point is that is, here I am writing that point. The stigma are sticky and feathery. Sticky and feathery.
Feather is that? You know that the feather.
Suppose this is the stigma surface. This is the stigma surface. And basically, feathery stigma means that tip is having the stigma, which are
feather like. That's why
the pollen grain will come, and that will fall on the feathery stigma, and it can easily stuck in the feathery stigma surface,
and it will be involved in the fertilization process. Okay.
Then mostly example here, you can say two examples are there. One is your red palm, and another one is your maize. These are two basic examples. Or these are two plants
where we see
in the date palm plant and maize plant,
where you will see there is pollination occurs through the agency of wind
or the air, and that flowers are called as which flower? That is called as anemophilous flowers.
Clear?
Go through these points, then we will know another important type of flower, that is your hydrophilic.
Okay, that pollination occurs through the agency of water.
Note on these points. Okay. Another important point is that, movement of pollen grain. Is non-directional.
If the movement of any specific object, or
when say the pollen grain, it is going in a specific direction,
it may be east or west, then it is called as a directional movement.
And if there is no direction, specific direction for the transfer of pollen grain from the surface of the anther, then it will be non-directional. Suppose the air flows from this side, then pollen grains will move, the anther will move to this side. And suppose the air flows from this side, then the pollen will be released to this side.
There is no specific direction for the transfer of the pollen gas. That may release any direction of the air. Clear?
And this is the important point of the
anemophilous flower.
Okay. Note on these points. Already we have discussed the one first type of, that is your anemophilous flower. Then let us discuss another second important type of parvating agent, that is your hydrophilic. And the name indicates that is hydro, that is related to water. We already know that hydro water, that is related to water. And basically the hydrophilous flower, the pollination occurs through the agency of water.
Here,
pollination occurs through the agency of water. Basically the hydrophilous flower, they are small in size and inconspicuous. Already we know that inconspicuous flower, that are not so in nature,
they are very small in nature, and that cannot be seen easily our naked eye.
And basically in flowers, the pollen grains are light in weight, small in weight, light, small and unweightable. As they are very light in weight and their surface is unweightable.
They are having a waxy coating so that water will not be easily stuck onto the surface of the pollen grain.
That's it. They cannot easily weigh. Yeah. And next important point is that stigma is sticky. Stigma is sticky. As stigma is sticky surface, so that the pollen grain which are present in the water surface, they can easily stuck on the surface and then form the
jelly.
Okay, clear. Then next important point is that the hydrophilous flower can be of two types, one is hypohydrogamous and second one is for that epihydrogamous.
Okay,
hypo and hydrogamous, epi and hydrogamous. And hypo means the pollination will occur in the flower which will occur below the surface of water level.
Okay.
Pollination will occur in flower which will below the surface of water. And here basically in the epihydrogamous we see epi means above. Okay, hypo means below. The name already indicates that
the pollination which will occur below the water surface, below the water level, that is called as
hypohydrogamous. And epi, that is the pollination will occur, and the pollination will occur on the surface of water, surface level of water, surface level of water. Yeah. Suppose this is a water surface. Okay. And if the flowers, the pollination occur inside the below the surface, that is called as your hypohydrogamous. And if the flowers, the pollination are present on the surface and that will fall on the stigma surface which is present at the surface, that is what called as your epihydrogamous. Clear? And if we say the example of hypohydrogamous flower, that is your Drosera plant, that is present
below the surface level of water.
And here in the empty halo numbers, that is example we use hydrilla. And another example of plant, that is Alicinaria. These are two examples where you will find empty halo numbers, pollination numbers.
Okay. Note on these points, then we will discuss about the biotic agents of pollination. Already we have discussed the abiotic agents of pollination. Then let us discuss some of the biotic agents. Already we know biotic agents means obviously the living organisms will be involved in the transfer of pollen grain, and
the biotic agents there is agency here is your living organism. That living organisms may include different types. It may include vertebrates, okay? Vertebrates, invertebrates, several organisms are there.
And vertebrates, you know that? Those are having this minor chord of vertebral column that are called as vertebrates.
And those are not having
vertebrates that are called as invertebrates. And basically, most of the vertebrates like your birds, your animals, like your human beings that are involved in the pollination process. And if you consider the different types of organisms, a specific organism that can be divided into a specific group of pollination and that are named according to that.
Okay. And basically, four types and fast individual biotic agents may include Jubilee, and second one that is your Entomophilae. And part that is ornithophilic, and fourth that is your thyrophilic, and fifth last one monadophilic. These are five types of your pollination that is
involvement of biotic agents or living organisms. Then, first we will discuss about the zoophily.
Obviously, the zoo agent is here, and here pollination occurs through the agency of pollination of birds. So, animals, different types of animals are involved in the zoophily type, and basically, your human beings. Birds, reptiles, these are included in the zoophily type. Okay, different types of reptiles, human beings, birds are included in the zoophily type. Then rodents are also included. Rodents. Okay, these are called as zoophily. Then next. Important type that is your entomophily, and here entomophily means here the pollination will occur through the agency of insects. Here different types of insects involved in the pollination process, and mostly the example here in nature moths. Butterflies, then wasps, bees. Okay. These are different types of insects. Mostly moths, then butterflies, then wasps and bees. These are involved in the pollination.
And the entomophilous covers the pollination that are occurred through the agency of insect.
That is called as entomophilous cover. Entomophilous. Flower.
Basically, this is opposite to your anopheles flower, and the anopheles flower, we know that these are small and inconspicuous, but here the flowers are
conspicuous and having
specific odor. Clear? Is it having any odor? Can you say that?
Same. S-C-E-N-T.
They are having a specific type of smell. Okay. The sepals and petals, they will having a specific type of smell, so that insects will be attracted to that
entomophilous flower.
And basically this scent or the odor that is present in the flower, that will attract the different types of insects, and they will attract it and they will receive some type of fluid that is present in the flower, and that fluid is called as nectar. You can see nectar is present here. Nectar is present, and that nectar will be fed by the insects, so that it will the different types of insects that they will come and sit on the surface of the flower, and they will receive the nectar which is present on the flower. And this nectar basically is composed of your sucrose, fructose, then glucose, different types of protein, amino acid. Clear? These are basically present in case of nectar. And this is the composition of nectar. If we say the chemical composition of nectar, then it is composed of sucrose, glucose, protein, and amino acid. And that will be fed by your insect, and that's why nectar is present in case of entomophilous flower, and it is absent in case of anemophilous flower. And basically, the pollen grains, another important point is that pollen grains are spiny. Okay, spiny means their surface is spiny like that. The surface will be spiny, so that the tentacles of the insect, they will stuck on the surface of the spine of the pollen grain, and they will easily travel from one surface to the other surface. And the stigma here is, stigma is sticky. Okay, and the spiny pollen grain that will fall on the sticky surface, and it will attach to the surface of your stigma, and it can be easily transferable from one surface to other surface. Okay, and basically the tentacles which is present in the insect will help in the transfer of pollen. Okay, note on these points, then we will discuss about few some points of your endophilous flowers. Note on these points. Okay, let us discuss another few points of endophilous flowers.
Then these flowers are showing. Flowers are showy in nature and conspicuous. Already we discussed this point in groups. Usually flowers are showy as they are bright in color. They will sow in nature and they will attract the insect, so that the insect will be attracted to that flower. And the conspicuous nature is that the flowers can easily identified or easily seen by your naked eye. And small flowers are present, but they occur in groups. These small flowers usually occur in groups, so that they are conspicuous or they will easily seen or easily visible in nature. And next important point is that some pollen grains are edible, that you can take into a diet. You can include it, that pollen grain, into a diet, and that is example that is rosa and jasmine. These are two examples of your pollen grains, which are edible pollen grains. Clear? Then next important type, that is your ornithophyllum. And basically ornithophyllum means that pollination occurs by wind. Pollination occurs through agency of not wind, that is agency of birds.
mostly two types of ionic see that it involved in the communication, that is sunbar and humming bar. These are two types of bar that are involved in the pollination process. And basically if you say the ornithophilus flower, these are unique flower because these are larger in size. Okay, these are larger in size and it is odorless or it is having no scent in nature. And basically the larger flowers, obviously there will be larger staminate stigmas surface and the sunbird and hummingbird, when they will come for the search of your nectar, obviously the bars are coming, obviously there is presence of mucilaginous nectar, mucilaginous nectar is very ingredient. And mucilaginous nectar is that, mucilaginous means semi-liquid, okay, or it is slightly gummy in nature. And that nectar, we know that nectar having sucrose, fructose, glucose, and which is a nutritive in nature. And that for the nectar, different sulfur and hummingbird, they come and feed on that nectar and indirectly will help in the pollination process. And next important point is that stigma is sticky. Stigma is sticky. Sticky in nature. Here, and basically they will fall on the surface of the stigma and they will be involved in the pollination process. Here, and another important point is that flowers are bright in color. Okay, flowers are bright in color. As they are bright in color, they will, the different parts will attract it and they will come and they will help in the transfer of the pollen grains. And next important point is that, next important type, that is your chiropterophyllin. Chiropterophyllin. And in this type, the pollination it is occurred by, pollination occurred to the agency of bats. Okay, and mostly bat, if you know that, they will present at the night time or active in the night time. That's why the flowers are open in, open during night. During night or evening time? Night or evening. And mostly example here it is your chiropterophyllin example, that is your Ange and Bombax. These are two examples, okay? That is your Ange and Bombax. And the ornithophyllin example, that is your sunbird and hummingbird. And the edible pollen grain example, that is your rosa and jasmine. And last important type, that is in the malacophyllin. Already we have discussed that malacophyllin, that is pollination that will occur through the agency of snail. Pollination occurs through the agency of snail. And example here is your Aresa mia. Okay. This is the example. Where you will find the malacophyllin type of pollination will occur. Okay. These are the basic types of ionic agents of pollination. In today's class, what we have discussed in details about the different types of agents of pollination. That is abiotic agent, that is your anemophilus, the air pollinated flowers, then hydrophilus, that is water pollinated flowers, that are two types, hypohydrogamous and epihydrogamous. Hypo, the flowers, the pollination will occur below the surface of water, and epi means the pollination will occur on the surface. And biotic, we have discussed different types of living organisms which are involved in the pollination process, that are zoophily, then entomophily, that is involvement of insects, ornithophily, involvement of birds, then chiropterophyllin, involvement of, that is your bats, then lastly malacophyllin, involvement of some types of snails. Okay,
In today's class, these topics we have discussed. Go through these points. In the next class, we will discuss about the pollen-crystal interaction and cell-field compatibility. See you in next class. Thank you.